Well, a very good evening and welcome to TELUS. I'm David Dundee, Director of Education. I'm so glad you're here this evening to enjoy the opening of our new material science exhibit. And I want to point out that we have a planetarium show at 8 o'clock, and also our observatory will be open until 10 o'clock outside. So be sure to visit that, and the museum will be open until 9. If for any reason you need to leave the theater for whatever, the program also will play in the Great Hall if you need to be outside the theater for any reason. And I want to tell you about our next lecture in the series, that will be Dr. George Green of the Global Water Center. Will be here on April the 8th, and he'll be talking about the global water crisis. And this will be actually the theme of our spring break week. And we will actually have the Mobile Discovery Center coming in from Charleston, South Carolina, and exploring the world of water, where it comes from, where it comes from in the solar system, where it comes from on Earth, and how people around the world can get clean drinking water. And that exhibit will spring up behind the museum starting on Wednesday. They're going to construct it, and it will be three tractor trailers full of exhibits, and a geodesic dome will spring up with a continuously running programs, and there'll be some family activities under tents, and so it really will be an exciting time. That'll be here April 2nd through the 10th, all during spring break. So please don't miss that, and don't miss Dr. Green on April 8th. He'll be here, the founder of that group, to talk here at the museum that night. Coming up here at the museum, we'll be opening tomorrow officially to the public our material science exhibit, and we have in the audience, at least I hope so, some VIPs that helped build this exhibit. So there's way back there is Ms. Melsheimer there, and Rebecca, go ahead, stand up, Rebecca, take a bow. Rebecca was really the person behind making this exhibit happen, and I thought I saw Amy, Gramsci. She ran away. Oh, okay. Director of Curatorial Services, and also David Story is where did he go? Nope. Okay. And we have a volunteer also in our audience who was crucial in getting this exhibit together, and Jay Gorday is right there. So, as you go through this exhibit, this is not a traveling exhibit. This exhibit actually was inspired, thought up, designed, and built all in-house. So it's really, really, really cool. So we're very, very proud of that. And to honor this special night that we're opening this exhibit, we have the honor of hosting for our talk tonight, Mark Losego. And Dr. Losego is an associate professor in the School of Materials Science and Engineering at Georgia Tech. And he is going to be talking about materials, the science of stuff. What a great, great title. And Mark his research lab studies materials processing for semiconductor, microelectronics, sustainable energy technologies, technical textile applications. He teaches courses in material science, processing, introductory survey courses in material sciences, and offerings to all engineering majors. We're excited to have Dr. Losego with us tonight. So please welcome Dr. Mark Losego.
All right, thank you, David. Thank you very much. Really a pleasure to be here. The exhibit, I talked to Rebecca several months ago about it, and it's beautiful. Really represents well, material science and what it's about. And so I'm really happy to be here tonight to share with you some of my thoughts on materials and, materials engineering and material science and, the science of stuff, because really that's what material science is. It's about all the stuff that's around us. Ultimately, it's made of materials. The seats you're sitting on, the lights, the screen, all these things are different materials and they're serving a purpose. That's really important to modern life. Behind me on the screen are optical fibers. And so a lot of these times, these materials we don't even notice, right? These optical fibers are running throughout this building, throughout the world really, carrying all of our data on the internet through light. And so that's really what I want to talk about today. Where materials interact and interface with us, in an everyday life. And so I have kind of three main points I want to get across. First, that materials are everywhere, and we don't always notice them. And that the structure of these materials, it's not just the chemistry, it's not just picking elements off the periodic table and putting them together. There's actually more complexity to that structure, and we'll talk about that a bit, and how that complexity in its structure, in a structure of a material, gives it the properties that we experience. And lastly, all materials come from somewhere. They don't just come from the store. They have to be manufactured at some point. And there's a lot of science behind how we manufacture materials and then how they get to their end use. So let me start with materials being everywhere. And they do a lot of things for us. And again, we don't always think about the things that they do for us. So we don't even notice it. Think about all the stuff that we own. Think about all the stuff that's around us. Our cell phones, for example. There's lots of components to those cell phones. There's the screen that's giving us light. There's the battery that's giving us power. There's the back that we want a certain color, right? And so we can show our friends, but we want to make sure it doesn't get scratched. So all those require different materials to get those properties that we want. What about the clothes we wear? Certain clothes need to perform certain functions, like raincoats. There's a great demo in the exhibit where they coated even just regular clothes to make them super water resistant. Now, how can we do that? Refrigerators, think about thermal properties of materials. How about your bed? You want it to be comfy, right? You don't want it to be hard to sleep on. You want a comfy bed. So how do we make materials to do that? And also, probably keep us cool in the summer. Electricity, we need materials that conduct electricity. Our toaster, there's all these parts, right? There's the thermal insulation because we don't want to burn ourselves touching the outside while it's cooking on the inside. There's actually a little sensor in there that changes its function or its structure with temperature to trigger when to pop the toast up. So there's, even in a simple appliance like a toaster, there's many different material components that we need to get the function that we want. What about your contact lenses? You put those that wear contact lenses, you put them in your eye every day, you don't think about what is this thing I'm sticking in my eye and why isn't it bothering my eye? In fact, this is a very interesting material. It's a hydrogel, it's a polymer material, but it's actually not very much polymer, it's mostly water. And if you've ever left a contact laying on the tabletop, it just dries up and shrivels up and gets really small. I actually have to share with you today some hydrogels. I'll kind of pass these around in the audience for you all. They start out though, I grew these hydrogels. They start out these little beads, not real big, but you put them in water and they grow to maybe 10 times the size that they started out as. And I'll pass them around. You can take multiple. I have two large buckets here. This is a particularly large one though here. But again, 95% water. And so of course our body is mostly water. And so having a material that's mostly water allows it to be very compatible with the human body. So these are freebie giveaways. I'll try to even out. See, there's lots. So feel free to take a few home with yourselves. There, you can buy them on Amazon I got a pack of probably 10,000 for like 10 bucks. So you can buy them. They're actually marketed. Well, I've seen people use them in weddings at their wedding receptions to hold their flowers, and they also market them to water your plants when you leave. The water will seep out over the course of a week or so to keep your plants watered. But think even bigger. There's all kinds of materials all around us every day, right? Think about your car. And inside your car, you know, a car is not one material. It has all these components that need to do all these different things. I can't even list all the things, right, in this car. But you have, you know, your headlamps, your windshield, you need to see through, the seats need to be, you know, comfy for you to sit in. But take even one component, like the tire. You think, oh, yeah, that's rubber, right? But in fact, if you start to cut away what a tire looks like, it actually has many material layers in it. It has, you know, metals, it has textiles in it to give the performance, to give the longevity, the durability that we need for our tires. How about bigger still? Bridges, all the concrete, steel cables that we put in our roads and our bridges, in our airplanes, thinking about, you know, the new Boeing 787 Dreamliner is the first plane to have a composite fuselage. So instead of being made of metal, like aluminum, for a long time, there's a really nice demo actually out there. You can see the difference between the density of aluminum and steel. Aluminum's so much lighter, and it's really important for fuel efficiency, right? And to keep it flying. But composites, carbon composites, are lighter still. And so now moving planes to carbon composites, you know, even enhances the fuel efficiency of flight even more. And then what about spacecrafts, of course? The bottom side, while they're coming in, all that heat that builds up, we need materials that will be able to withstand that heat, but more importantly, you know, be thermal insulators so that, you know, the humans inside don't get cooked inside the space shuttle. This is, you know, this material is actually very similar to the aerogel. They have some demos out there showing, you know, how aerogels actually protect from flame. They have a video showing the flower with a blowtorch underneath the aerogel getting red hot and not hurting, you know, the flower on top. And all this stuff, you know, requires materials with specific properties. And so you can start to see the different properties that we care about as material scientists. You know, ultimately, as materials engineers, we want to think about what's the end application and how do we get a material to perform with the property we need for that application. So in bridges, you might think about, you know, the strength of those materials, the mechanical properties of those materials. With electrical things, you want to think about how electricity interacts with those materials, the electrical properties. Of course, there's a number of cases where, you know, we care about how light, like on the first slide, the optical fibers, how light interacts with the material. And so we think about the optical properties of the material. Sometimes you want reflection, sometimes you want absorption. Really great demo in the exhibit, the Vanta Black, how that perfectly absorbs light, right? That's the optical properties of the material. And then think about corrosion, the chemical properties, how materials interact with other chemicals, maybe to corrode them. But in fact, batteries are effectively doing the same thing. The battery in your phone or your laptop, you're effectively corroding that material inside over and over again. You're corroding and uncorroding it. That's how the battery works. And so understanding the chemical properties of materials is really important. Of course, the thermal properties, as we talked about with the spaceship or just your refrigerator at home or your toaster. And then there's what we call cross properties, where multiple of these properties kind of interact with each other, right? So here, this is a bimetallic strip where you heat it up and the thermal expansion of the two metals here are sort of different from one another and it causes it to expand. In fact, coming back to a toaster, this is basically the switch that's used to turn the toaster on and off to make sure it doesn't burn the toast is a sort of cross property of thermal expansion. So that's what, you know, material science is all about, is trying to get to these different properties of the material for the certain application that we need, right? And how do we get to these properties? Well, we start with making the material and understanding how the making of that material leads to the structure of that material, how the atoms in that material are arranged and how the other structural components are sort of structured in the material. And then ultimately, that structure is what causes the properties of material. So if there's one thing about material science, if you go in, if you study material science at all, really, even if you're another type of engineer or scientist and you take just a general class in material science, this is the first thing we teach you. that there's this interrelationship between how you make the material, the structure that you get from that material, and how that structure then creates the properties. This is the core paradigm of material science: process, structure, property, relationships. I want to take a moment here, step back, and just talk a little bit about structure, try to get us thinking as material scientists what we mean by the structure of a material. So I'm going to have I am a professor, so I have a pop quiz. I have a pop quiz for you all. Hopefully an easy one. What makes up, what's the smallest particles that we say that make up all substances in the universe? Think we know? Go for it.
Quarks or atoms?
Oh, quarks are really small. I'll go with your second answer. Atoms. That's right. So at least, you're going to be a physicist. Are you going to be a physicist? Yeah, when we go smaller than atoms, that's when we get into the realm of physicists. But for us lowly engineers, we're good with atoms. And I have another question, actually, for either of you. Why should you never trust an atom? That's right. They make up everything. All right. Yeah, okay. All right. That's a little humor.
There's antimony, arsenic, aluminum, selenium, and hydrogen, and oxygen, and nitrogen, and rhenium, and nickel, neodymium, neptunium, germanium, and iron, americium, ruthenium, uranium, europium, zirconium, lutetium, vanadium, and lanthanum, and osmium, and astatine, and radium, and gold, protactinium, and indium, and gallium, and iodine, and thorium, and thulium, and thallium. There's yttrium, ytterbium, actinium, rubidium.
This is what we have to work with, right? Our periodic table. You know, we can kind of eliminate some of these that don't exist for very long, and some of the radioactive ones. But otherwise, we can pick from all of these elements, and that's certainly part of the structure of the material. Is the chemistry of the material. But that's what I want to get across here in my second point, is that materials are not just their chemistry. Or in other words, the structure, when we talk about the structure of a material, it's more than just its composition or just its chemistry. And it's often the defects in the material, the things that we think of as being, you know, imperfections in the material, that create a lot of the interesting properties, or what I say, a lot of fun in the material. So let's consider, for example, the polymer polystyrene. Actually, one of the first exhibits shows something similar to this. So if you think about polystyrene, it's a polymer. Polymers in general are long chains. So you know, if you've ever taken high school chemistry, you started drawing molecules, and you know carbon makes four bonds. And you can imagine you could add one carbon, then add another carbon, and you could add hundreds or thousands of carbons. And that's effectively what a polymer is. It's just a long chain of carbons. Polystyrene happens to have these rings hanging off the side. And that's kind of makes the difference in the chemistries of our different polymers. But effectively, they're long chains. And you can imagine if you ever, who's eaten a bowl of spaghetti? Have we eaten bowls of spaghetti? Yeah, so the spaghetti chains, right, are a lot like our polymer chains. And in a bowl of spaghetti, they all kind of entangle with each other. And that's how we think about the structure at a basic level, the structure of polymers, okay? But it turns out that even at that very simple picture, we can get different structural features of how those chains entangle with one another. And in fact, these are all three polystyrene cups. Okay, they're all made of the same exact chemistry. In fact, they could even be the same polymer lengths. They're effectively identical. But we've processed them. When we made them, we had this goo of polymer in the hot liquid state. When we then solidified them, we solidified them slightly differently to give us slightly different arrangements of those chains to give us clearly different structures, different properties in these materials. So this one here is actually completely amorphous. This looks just like our plate of spaghetti. It's completely random. If it's random, we call it an amorphous structure. This one here actually has some order to it. Some of the chains, for portions of them, kind of start to align with each other, and they form what we call crystalline portions of the material. So it's semi-crystalline, because we have some crystalline, some amorphous. Now, interestingly here, these crystalline portions are about the size of the wavelength of light. And if anything's about the size of the wavelength of light, what it does is it causes the light to scatter. And that's why this is no longer fully transparent. It's kind of translucent, it's kind of hazy looking. That's because these crystalline regions are scattering the light just a little bit and causing this hazy appearance. And then lastly, we have, of course, our styrofoam. And I'll say that the image here is much bigger, length scales. Here, we're zoomed in much higher and looking at the chains, or at least pictorially looking at the chains. Here now, we're zoomed out quite a bit, and we're seeing these large pores. And basically, we've blown air, or somehow we've maybe had something that created some sort of gas inside of it to leave these large pores inside of that material. Now, from a material standpoint and a property standpoint, what does this get us? Well, this actually gets us, you know, air is a much better thermal insulator than any solid. And so this makes this a much lower thermal conductivity material. So of course, we use our styrofoam cups to drink our coffee, just like the aerogel that you can see in the exhibit, or the space shuttle tiles on the space shuttle. They have a lot of air in them, trapped in them, to make them high thermal conductivity to protect you from the heat on the other side. In this case, maybe the coffee that you're drinking. So again, we see here how, you know, structure goes many different length scales. It's not just about the chemistry we choose. We can have the exact same chemistry, but end up with very different structures and very different properties in our materials. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about structure. We do start though with the atoms, and I don't know, we can try to zoom in here. Maybe let's see if I can get this. For metals anyway, this is a really nice setup. Let's see if we can catch this on the camera. For metals, so I can put this right there. Okay, so for metals, we can actually think about if perhaps we learned in high school chemistry classes that metallic bonding, you sort of share electrons everywhere. And so what that leads to is the atoms just wanting to pack as closely as they can so they can share their electrons as much as possible. And so they pack as tightly as they can, which is basically the same as balls will pack, or these are BBs inside this case here. And this is actually what the structure, and I'll show you a picture in a second, this is what the structure of many metals look like. But what I'll point out is there's sort of like a hole missing here. There's sort of there's this defect. There's kind of the nice pattern, and then it kind of shifts a little bit right along this line here. There's another hole, and there's sort of different orientations. And these defects, these same exact defects, happen in materials. And it's these defects that create a lot of the properties in our materials. So here's actually a zoomed-in electron microscopy image where we're actually basically seeing the atoms just like I showed on those balls there. And you can see sort of nicely this six-fold arrangement around the center atom. But then, you know, right here we have this disorder, and sort of you can see the lines, the planes of atoms here run one way, while the planes kind of run a different way here. They're kind of misoriented from each other. We call these different regions grains, and these grain boundaries between them. But these boundaries are defects that we can create in material. And there's a variety of other defects like missing atoms and so on. And this leads to what we call the microstructure. So we zoom out a little bit more, and we start to see, you know, these grain boundaries. We see that's what all these lines are in here, is all these grain boundaries in the material. And depending on, you know, how big and small these grains are, we can manipulate the properties of these materials, leading to, you know, the structural and electrical and optical performance that we desire. And, you know, this crystal structure can just be really beautiful. This is the structure of a garnet crystal, of a ceramic. And so now, instead of in metals, again, we're just trying to pack as tightly as we can. In ceramics, we have more ionic and covalent character. And perhaps you learned in high school chemistry with covalent bonds, you have very specific bond orientations, bond directions. And so you get fixed sort of structures. These are tetrahedrons, and you have octahedrons here. And so because they're very fixed orientations, we can't pack them quite as tightly, but you still get these patterns. You can kind of see how these green tetrahedrons kind of go up and down. And so this is how any crystalline material is. We get this repeating pattern, or these pink octahedrals kind of cant left and right and left and right as they go across. It's just really a beautiful sort of geometry that dictates the structure of these materials. But the interesting thing is just a small amount of defects in here. We draw these like perfect structures, but just small amounts of defects can actually make really huge differences in the properties of these materials. So take, for example, aluminum oxide, corundum. It's you know, a pretty simple ceramic material. The structure is kind of, you know, looks maybe a little complex, but it's not really that complicated for a material. It's just aluminum and oxygen atoms. And, you know, it's found in a lot of places. These are just kilnware if anyone does ceramic work. You know, it's kind of got this dull beige type of color. Or sandpaper, the grit is often silica or alumina. You know, kind of, you know, you can even say this is dirt cheap, all right, to buy. Just to show you, you know, this is single crystal alumina wafers. And so alumina in and of itself should be transparent. But what happens when you put a little bit of defects in? Well, then you get your gemstones, right? And it doesn't require very much, but these are all essentially corundum alumina with just a little bit of our transition metals, chromium, iron, vanadium, etc., to give us this color. And the addition of these defects, of these transition metals, is only on the order of maybe 0.01% to get that color. One out of every 10,000 atoms is replaced. So this is the power of defects in materials. We can get a lot of different properties from the defects. Another good example is semiconductors, which are used for all of our microelectronics, our computers, cell phones, HD TVs, and so on. Okay, don't get scared, I have a graph. Okay, I do have a plot up here. I'll walk us through this. We plot here the electrical resistivity, how conductive it is. This is more resistance, this is more conductive, right? But what I'll have you notice is that this axis is changing by factors of 10. So these are huge changes in conductivity, of electrical conductivity of the material, as a function of how much impurity, how many defects I'm adding. So I'm adding either boron or phosphorus in this case, and this is how much it's changing with those defects. So let's look at these defects. Well, first of all, let's look at the change. We're talking about 100,000 or 1 million time change in resistivity with just adding some defects to this material. There's two things that's really impressive here. First of all, you know, these high resistances are coming from silicon wafers that are created with just 10 to the minus 9 impurities. So we're talking approaching 1 trillionth, one part per trillion defects in these materials. So the first thing that's really impressive is that we actually are able to create single crystals of silicon with like parts per trillion defects, like that low of a defect density, that low of an impurity density in the material. The second thing that's really impressive is that we only need to add, again, like 1 to 2 out of 10,000 atoms to get this 1 million time change in conductivity. And so not very many defects, and we get this huge change. And the thing, you know, to get all these microelectronics to work, we need to spatially create different concentrations to get different conductivities spatially at sort of the nanometer length scale. So we're controlling the amount of impurities at sort of a nanometer length scale to give us these huge changes in conductivity to get all of our microelectronics. And that's just, it's an amazing accomplishment of science and technology. Okay, so both of these examples were examples of impurities. But you're saying, well, you know, I told you it's not all about chemistry. So I'm gonna show you another example here where I don't change the chemistry of the material at all. I introduce defects, though, into the material to dramatically change properties.
Here's a piece of copper tubing. This copper is actually pretty pure, and it's been annealed to make it really soft. We usually think of metals as being pretty strong materials, but in fact, in their pure elemental state, and without many defects in them, they're pretty easy to bend, like this piece of copper tubing. See, we can bend that pretty easily, but now what we've done is we've actually created a lot of defects inside of this material. And those defects now make it more difficult for the atoms to move. So if we want to bend it again, it becomes much more difficult. So I'll try to straighten it out. See, I can do it, but it's definitely a bit harder. Now, as I've straightened it out, I'm putting additional defects into that piece of copper. With those additional defects, I've increased the strength even more. So if I want to bend it one more time, in that same spot gets much more difficult to bend. And as I continue to add defects, it's going to get stronger and stronger. So if I want to bend it back, straightening it out now becomes very difficult. And that's how we strengthen materials. This is actually a way that we process materials. We process metals. We purposely put defects in them. We do something called cold working. We put defects in to increase their strength. And that's how we get really strong metals and alloys, the kind that we use to build our cars, to build our airplanes, and to build our bridges.
Okay, so let me take that to the extreme. I have another demo here. What if we put in sort of an infinite number of defects? So I have two metals here, effectively the same composition, but one has, this one here has like an infinite number of defects in it, and this one is more, you know, perfectly crystalline. And I have, just ball bearings. I'm going to drop them in this, and we'll watch to see what happens. Still going. Okay, so this is a standard metal like you would buy, you know, anywhere in your car or whatnot. This one is still bouncing. It's called an amorphous metal, or a bulk metal, metallic glass. It's basically completely defective. Just like the polymer, it basically, the atoms are randomly arranged. And in fact, what's really interesting is if you look at the surface of these, I just have a picture here, the amorphous metal looks perfectly clean, no defects on it. What happens in the crystalline metal, why the ball stops bouncing, is effectively when it lands on the metal, it just like I did with the copper, it introduces defects into that material. And the introduction, the creation of those defects is the energy of the ball bearing goes into the metal to create those defects. And we can see the pits and stuff that have been left behind. Whereas since we can't create any more, this is completely amorphous, we essentially can't create any more defects, so the energy from that ball bearing dropping is returned to the ball bearing completely, and it basically continues to bounce. And so these are called bulk metallic glasses. Again, this is what our crystalline structure looks like. The metallic glass is just completely random. And it's used in a number of spaces now, including the faces of golf clubs, knife edges because they don't wear out very quickly, and then gearboxes, the gear teeth basically don't wear out very quickly. Okay, that takes us to pop quiz number two. How many phases of matter are there? Oh. Four, yeah, what are your phases of matter? Solid, liquid, gas. Oh, I gave you a hint. Yeah, and a plasma, okay. So as we heat up any substance, we can go from a solid, we transform it to a liquid, we transform it to gas, we transform it to plasma. In fact, in Georgia, I've learned that in second grade, we learn states of matter. And so we learned this pretty early on. What I'll argue, or okay, and so if we think about these phases, when we define what a phase is, you know, in all these cases, you know, we're talking about the same substance. And so what makes it a different phase? Well, in material science, we do talk about different chemistries being different phases, but in this case, what makes them different phases is the fact that their atomic arrangements or their molecular arrangements are different, right? This is really well packed together in the solid, and in fact, it has a crystalline order. There's an ordered pattern to it, ice does. Liquid, on the other hand, the molecules are farther apart and they're more random in their order. And then, of course, gas, you get even further, and then you rip apart the atoms in a plasma. But they're all the same chemistry. And so many materials themselves actually have different phases within them. So the solids themselves can have different atomic arrangements. So, for example, consider silicon dioxide. These are three of the atmospherically atmospheric pressure phases of silicon dioxide. So with increasing temperature, you go from the quartz to the tritomite to the cristobalite phase. And so this is the tetrahedron of silicon and four oxygens. And you can see sort of the pattern, right? The pattern of the quartz clearly looks different than tritomite, clearly looks different than cristobalite. So they're all solids, but the atoms are arranged differently in those solids. And then, of course, you know, silica that we're probably most familiar with is glass, like window glass, and it has this amorphous structure that I've mentioned before. What do we know about phase transformations? Well, you know, we can go back to what we know from, you know, even elementary school, what we know about phase transformations. We know that the transition from one state, like a solid to a liquid, occurs at a very specific temperature, right? And so we know ice to liquid, that's at 32 Fahrenheit or 0 Celsius, and then water to steam, 100 Celsius or 212 Fahrenheit. And the other thing is that they're reversible, right? It's the same chemistry. I can just go back and forth. I don't lose anything in that way. And solid phase transformations are effectively the same. They have the same properties. They occur at specific temperatures, and they're reversible. And so we can use this as materials engineers to engineer materials to get us properties we care about. So we can think about it in the solid state. You know, one structure might look like this. Another arrangement of those atoms might look like this, and we can go back and forth and, again, occur at a precise temperature and be fully reversible. And they're the source of actually a lot of cool materials phenomena. And so we actually have, one of these demonstrations in the exhibit. It's the shape memory alloy one. Did anyone do the shape memory alloy? The demo, if you didn't get to do it, you should go afterwards. It's one of my favorites. Actually, the demo that brought me to material science when I was in high school, they showed me this, and I said, yep, that's what I want to be. So let's see where we are here. Okay, so this was a spring, but I've kind of bent the spring. This wire, this shape memory alloy wire, is a spring, had a spring shape initially, but it's not a very good spring because it doesn't really go back to its original shape. But what we can do with this is it has this phase transformation, just like I was talking about, where there's two different structures, and when I hit a certain temperature, it'll undergo that transformation. But this transformation is particularly special because in this particular case, for this particular alloy, it remembers its original shape. So if I put this in some hot water, it goes back to the original spring. So I'll do that again, just for anyone missed it. Spring. Stretch it out, kind of bend it the wrong way. And then we're going to undergo a phase transformation. This one's maybe 50 Celsius or so, not too hot. We go back, right back to the original shape. Now, this is interesting, and it's actually really useful. These shape memory alloys are used in a number of cases. One example is in stents that you put in your body and arteries. And in that case, what you do is you kind of crumple up the stent, you run it into the artery, and then you flow some electricity to it once it's positioned to heat it up, and then it goes back to its original shape to open the artery. Now, what I'll say is, you know, you don't always want to have to heat something up to get it to go back to its original shape. So this is where material science, materials engineering comes in. For example, if you wear glasses, particularly the kids in the audience, if you wear glasses and you happen to bend your glasses, what happens? Do your parents get angry if you bend your glasses? Yeah, but you don't. You're also, your parents probably also don't like you using like flames and stuff. So if you need to heat it up to fix your glasses, you probably don't want to do that. So what we'd really like to do is engineer an alloy, a metal alloy, that transformation temperature from the one phase to the other phase, that transformation temperature is now below room temperature, so that the transformation happens at room temperature. And that's what these glasses, the you've maybe seen them, but the alloy basically is the same. It's the same type of material, but now it has this super elastic property where it goes back to its prescribed shape immediately because the transformation is below room temperature, so it occurs right at room temperature. Okay, so last thing I want to talk about is, you know, where do all these materials come from? And I think this is really important because they don't all come from Walmart and Amazon. Although I did look on Amazon, you can buy silicon wafers. So if you want to start making microelectronics in your garage, you can buy them. They're pretty cheap, actually. So you can order a cassette of silicon wafers on Amazon. But Amazon didn't make them, right? They come from a number of places. And we can think about, you know, the history of materials and where materials came from, you know, way back at the early days of human existence. You know, they do probably about the same as I would do, which is you went around in the world and started just finding things, right? Like wood and stone and flint and even bricks, right? It was just clay being put together. And in fact, you know, we really appreciate materials because we name our early history based on the materials that we were using at that time. So of course we have the Stone Age, and then we discovered, you know, metals like copper and tin that we could start to melt in fires at fairly low temperatures and start making things like bronze, which, you know, were stronger, and I guess we could make better weapons to kill each other is basically what happened. And then we found that we could, in fact, you know, if we put a little bit of carbon into iron that we found, we could melt this at reasonably low temperatures and start to make steel. And besides lowering the process temperature, the carbon actually makes the steel stronger as well. It adds a defect to the material that makes it stronger. And so these started breaking the bronze swords, so they started winning out, and we entered the Iron Age. But if you look at this sort of this timeline of materials and the material development, you really notice that it's really right around 1900 that we start exploding all these different materials. And this doesn't capture, of course, all the materials that we have now. But it's really only over the last 100, 120 years that we've really entered the age of materials, and we really designed them, you know, for our needs. And so, you know, but we need to, you know, we had to figure out how to make all these, and making them is a complex process. You know, we think about all the materials that we have. These are kind of the three fundamental classes of materials: your polymers, your metals, your ceramics, and then composites or mixtures of these different classes. And each of these, you know, have a variety of ways of making these materials, right? Even a simple, you know, metal alloy that we'd want to, you know, purchase for, you know, manufacturing or whatever, takes, you know, a huge number of steps to go from that, you know, original iron and other components into the final product, right? And they're adding in the defects, and they're removing the defects and all these things to get the structure and the chemistry that we need for a particular application. Because it's not just about the chemistry, it's also about the microstructure of these materials. And you can talk about the same thing for all different classes of materials. And I just picked one or two manufacturing methods, but there's, you know, hundreds of manufacturing methods that we use. This is an injection molding process to make plastics, anywhere from toys to, you know, parts for your car and so on. This is a vapor deposition process that's used for microelectronics, so we think of it as really fancy, but in fact, vapor deposition is used on a lot of other commodity items like drill bits to put hard coatings, or even if you ever looked inside your potato chip bag, it looks metallic on the inside, right? But it feels like a piece of plastic. That's because it is a piece of plastic, but they evaporated some aluminum on the inside, so it's a really thin layer of aluminum that basically blocks water from getting in to keep your potato chips crispy. And then, you know, this is a ceramic processing, tape casting process used for things like fuel cells or old magnetic tapes or capacitors that are in a lot of your microelectronics. So, you know, then there's one more type of manufacturing that maybe some of you are familiar with and you maybe even have at home. Who has one of these at home? This is sort of over the last, you know, 20 years or so become more and more popular. Does anyone have? Yeah, so a 3D printer, right? And the really nice thing about additive manufacturing and these other manufacturing lines, you're usually making the same product over and over again. Here you can customize, which is really great for, you know, personalized sorts of things. And for plastics, there's, you know, or polymers, there's great 3D printing capabilities. But folks are certainly working on ways to additively manufacture a lot of other materials like metals and ceramics. And I have an example here. We're getting near the end, so I want to bring this back into the TELUS exhibit and the theme of superhero materials. And this last example here is from a colleague of mine, Dr. Aaron Stebner at Georgia Tech. He actually did this while he was still at the Colorado School of Mines, but he 3D printed this piece of metal to create a real life superhero. That's pretty cool, and you know, additive manufacturing has all these amazing capabilities. I mean, here we're basically, you know, shooting electrons or lasers effectively at powder beds to to solidify, re-solidify these into single components. This is how a lot of additive manufacturing metals is done. But you know, the challenge here is just what I showed, right? To make a metal alloy, there were 20, 30 steps, right? To control the microstructure and get the properties that you really want. And so, you know, there's a lot of science now that needs to be redone to figure out how to do that at a really fast time scale so that you can additively manufacture these things. Now my colleague, Dr. Stebner, you know, he did a really great job. Here they shot a pistol right at this. You see the bullet right before it's about to strike the armor here. And when it hit, this is what happened to it. It exploded. And this was what was left, just a little dent in the armor. So, I mean, they did a pretty good job here of getting the properties right. So that's pretty cool. With that, actually, I do have one last demo I do like to show. I like to end with a bang. This is my superhero material. This is probably my favorite superhero material. We talked about properties at the beginning. And this material, I told you about cross properties, where some materials can kind of, you know, have a property that connects two different classes of properties. And this one is called piezoelectric. Material. And a piezoelectric, what it does is it converts mechanical energy into electrical energy. And so effectively when I push on it, so I have a button here, and it's just pushing on this little piece of ceramic, this piezoelectric. There's no batteries or anything. And when I push on it, it generates a voltage, it generates electricity. This is amazing to me. The material's doing all the work. I'm pushing on it, and you can see that little spark. So okay, it might be hard to see in the back, so I'll add some fun juice to this canister, and then we can cut the lights in a second. All right, so I said we'll end with a bang. All right, so I told the second graders I presented to that we're going to blow something up, and they said afterwards, I didn't know it was going to be loud, and I said, well, I said I was going to blow something up, so okay, I'm warning you now, there's going to be a bang. All right, 3, 2. All right, there we go. So let me. That's how we end with a bang. To bring it home, just real quick here. Superhero materials. If you haven't seen it yet at the Crossroads Gallery, 3 takeaway messages. Materials are everywhere, even if we don't notice them. Structure is more than just the chemistry of the materials. And there's more than 4 phases of matter, in fact. And materials don't just come from Amazon. And I'll just remind you, tomorrow, Atlanta Science Festival ends with their Exploration Expo right at Piedmont Park in downtown, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Completely free. There'll be like 150 tents or so. Everything from biology to drones. Delta will be there, Georgia Tech, Emory, you know, anything you want to see. So this is a fun time all the time, and they do even bigger explosions. So thank you so much for the time. Happy to take a few questions.
All right. Thank you. If you've got a question, raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone over since we're recording this, and so everybody can hear your question. So I'm coming around with this young man back here.
I remember reading when I was a kid in popular science or something like that about buckyballs.
Oh yeah.
And I wondered, has that developed since I was a kid to something really fun and interesting? And
yeah, well, I mean, a lot of things. I mean, it led to nanotubes and now graphene, if you've heard of it. I mean, so, you know, one thing about buckyballs is really cool. I mean, Nobel Prize has been given for it, but, you know, I always say it's a big discovery when it changes the, you know, the high school or the freshman college level chemistry book. And that's really what it did, right? Because carbon, there was graphite, there was diamond, and there wasn't anything else. And then buckyballs came into existence, and that led to tubes and led to graphene. And sort of, you know, they're used in structural components to some extent now and to add conductivity to things. I think there's still, we talked about it earlier, you know, graphene, it still has all these amazing properties. It's how to get it from the this is always a challenge with nanoscale, how to get it from the nanoscale to interacting with us and all the things we do. But, you know, actually, the museum has a great example of the Vanta Black. Those are nanotubes that have been grown, and that's how they get that absorption, because the tubes are so long, and basically the light gets in there and it starts bouncing around and it can't get back out until it gets absorbed. And so there's another great example where these are used now.
All right. How about another question right here?
How much carbon is it in diamonds?
How much carbon?
Yes.
You want to guess how much? Like 100%. It's like 100% carbon in diamonds. Although a couple interesting things about diamonds. You can get blue diamonds, you can get yellow diamonds, just like I showed with those other gemstones, a little bit of impurity, boron, phosphorus, a couple other things. Now, interestingly, I don't know if you've seen, but there's actually synthetic diamonds now. We can synthesize diamonds. Now, for a long time, the challenge with synthesizing diamonds was keeping those impurities out. And they would end up with yellow and blue diamonds. And they would actually market them. For a while, they were marketing them as, hey, look, you get colored diamonds. But really, people just wanted the clear ones. And now they can do it. And now they sell synthetic diamonds, which there's a number of reasons you might want to do that or not. Depends on your preference.
What are the other states of matter?
What are the other states of matter? Yeah, so just like this shape memory alloy, we think it's not, we won't call it a state of matter, but a phase. We call them different phases. So when I bent this, it goes into one phase, and when I heat it up, it goes to another phase. It was like those different atom arrangements, right? You can pattern the atoms. You can have them in one pattern, or you can have them in another.
Up this way. Anybody have a ticket for the 8 o'clock show? I just want to let you know it's coming right up on 8 o'clock.
Hey, I have a question, and the question has a context. The question is, do scientists now have computer software that can 3D model the structure of a material and just virtually in there manipulate the structure, and once they have it, know what its properties are going to be? The context of the question is Star Trek IV, Voyage Home, transparent aluminum, which is probably what you guessed the context was going to be.
It was not. I don't know if I'm, okay. Or maybe Star, I won't show you my lab. We're maybe more Star Wars fans. But am I on?
Yeah, you're on.
Okay. Well, so this is a really good question, though. We were talking about this earlier. I was talking with the curators. You know, if we compare material science engineering to sort of our other engineering disciplines, you can do just that, right? Electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, you can model everything sort of perfectly with physics and predict what happens. Material science is not there yet. I mean, that's why it's called material science and engineering historically, because, you know, scientists discover things, engineers design things. We're trying to design things, and we can to some extent. It really depends, but typically you can't go from single atoms and all those, because we looked at those length scales, right? There's the atom level, there's the crystal level, there's the microstructure level, there's all these different length scales, and to model across all those length scales, if you had to model every atom in there, the computational need is just still way too great. We can do maybe like couple hundred atoms or something. We do work kind of with colleagues, and they're always like, oh yeah, that's a lot to compute. But on the other hand, what you can do is you can start modeling, you know, you can assume this group of atoms is going to behave the same, so like the different grains can behave the same. So depending on the problem and the system, you're going to model at different length scales and begin to predict properties in that way. But to do it from atom or electron all the way to, you know, bulk material, not really capable. Although, I mean, there are things, but you couldn't just randomly do anything at this point. Yeah, but that's like a huge space right now. And I'll add to it machine learning, right? The idea now is to not do the computations exactly, but start to see the trends and use machine learning to predict it, so not have to compute everything specifically. There's huge efforts in doing that. It's actually the Materials Genome Initiative, which was started by the Obama administration back in about 2010, 2012, which continues to ongo.
What are some new developments in materials from natural kind of inspiration, like spider silk the sea mussel adhesives, that kind of thing?
Yeah, I don't actually have my adhesive here, but yeah, I have a gecko adhesive. I mean, that's called biologically inspired, a lot of that. So yeah, there's a whole field of like understanding how certain biological systems do things well. And then this is a classic material science kind of area, is to, you know, you, even though it's now a biological system you're studying, you're using the tools like microscopy and spectroscopy to go and figure out what's the physics and the chemistry that's happening. And then once you understand that, how can we then process a material to get the same structure, same chemistry, and get the same properties? But yeah. That's bio-inspired design is basically that area, and there's a bunch of research. We at Georgia Tech, they have a center for bio-inspired design.
One of my colleagues had a roll of GEC tape, which was amazing. It's non-sticky adhesive tape that you could use over and over again.
Yeah, so the gecko foot has a bunch of cilia on it, and that's how it sticks to the walls from the Van der Waals forces, and people replicated that effectively in the materials.
Well, Dr. Losego, thank you so much for your time, and please enjoy the exhibit. The museum's open till 9, and I think Dr. Losego may make his way over there just to show some things at the demo table near the exhibit. Thank you all for being here.